hop on the old drunk tank. Hop on the old drunk tank. It's where all the gamers come rave and rant. So hop on the old drunk tank. Sit back, relax, cause it's time for the drunk tank.
I feel like I'm back in Alabama.
I feel like there should be small cartoon animals clapping along with that.
That was my favorite one yet.
That was a good one. I liked it. I don't know. I think every week we say it's our favorite one.
That's different.
No, not every week.
Oh, no, not you. Yeah, that's right.
Do you know, I've lived in Texas for most of my life, and I've never yelled yeehaw. That's a fucking blast.
That's the first time you've ever said yeehaw in your life.
Just yelled it like that? That's fun. Now I know why people do it.
Tomorrow you're going to come into work with a cowboy hat and spurs on.
I finally understand Yosemite Sam.
He was just hungry. He just wants to eat a rabbit.
I get nothing wrong with that. Did you ever see the explanation of why Wile E. Coyote is chasing Roadrunner? Did you ever see that cartoon?
No.
And he went.
Oh yeah, he goes through the dialogue showing like all the different cuts of meat on the Roadrunner.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, I've seen that.
And how each part of the Roadrunner is delectable and tastes different. Like there's a banana pudding section, and there's a filet mignon section.
And of course, the Roadrunner is so tiny that they're all just like tiny little slivers.
Hey, let's Let's finish this up and go to lunch.
Yeah.
I'm pretty hungry now.
I think
where can we get some Roadrunner? Do they have Roadrunner at Cafe 616?
We'll see.
I think that was the point at which I really started to switch and wanted Wile E. Coyote to catch the Roadrunner after I saw that cartoon.
Between that and seeing cartoon steaks all the time?
Yeah. No. I saw the infographic. It's like a metaphor for today's media. Once you see the pretty graphic, you're like, that makes sense. He's making really good points. I think he should eat the Roadrunner.
This is why we love USA Today, right? Infographics?
Exactly.
The Roadrunner needs to take one for the team. The hungry team.
Are you referencing the fact that FARC partnered with USA Today just this morning?
Yes, I am, actually.
Wow.
Oh, I didn't hear that.
Yeah.
Yeah, USA Today and FARC announced a partnership in which, and the weird thing is, I found out about this, and actually Drew, who owns FARC, linked it on his Twitter account, and he linked to an article on earthfirst.org. That was the organization that announced that. And so they're partnering for their Geek Tab. I'm not exactly sure exactly what they're doing, but yeah, FARC is now partnered with USA Today.
If only there was some other news organization he could have linked to.
who can we partner with? We need to partner with someone now.
I'm sorry, it's earthtimes.org.
Oh. Earthtimes.org.
Is that like the green version of Reuters or AP?
Well, I don't know. I wouldn't think that FARC is an overly environmental or USA Today. You want me to read the opening here?
Yeah, whatever.
USA Today, the nation's top-selling print newspaper and a leading online destination, I know it's in my bookmarks, announces a unique partnership with FARC.com, the news aggregator and edited social networking news site. Starting today, USAtoday.com's tech section, the one-stop guide for all things technology, will become the exclusive host and sponsor of the Geek page on FARC.com. The page is available at FARC.USAtoday.com. Interesting.
Hmm. Yeah. Well, I'm happy for Drew. That sounds like a really cool deal. I can't think of anything positive to say about USA Today, though.
I've seen it many times at hotels.
When's the last time any of you guys read USA Today?
The only time I ever read it is when I look at the headline to get it out of my way so I can walk out of my hotel
room.
Yeah,
I see it at hotel rooms a lot.
Yeah, that's about it, right?
But back when, I'm sure this is the case for everyone, but when I was a journalist, USA Today was like the joke of journalism. You know.
Well, I really like the connect the dots section. That's fun.
Well, here's something. I've read an article yesterday about how the guy who's running Twitter says that he would take the IPO route if necessary. He just raised another, I think, $200 million from, I guess, T. Rowe Price, an investment company, and another venture capital company, $200 million.
Why?
And he says that...
Can you repeat the name of the holding company so we can all sell our shares in it one more time?
Well, here's the thing. He says... if he needs, I guess, more money, he's valuing Twitter at, he believes, $1 billion. And so if you're in T. Rowe Price, or I think it was Insight Venture Capital, something like that, like an independent bunch of investors, I guess basically the plan would be, you know, to take this thing IPO. And if you're in T. Rowe Price or you're a venture capital person, that's when you cash in, when it's IPO'd. And then the, you know, whoever the firm is, they're going to add, you know, make advertisements about it. Get sucker investors to invest in it, and then that's when you sell.
Right.
You know, because what's the curve on Twitter, right? I mean, I don't know. Right now it's a name.
Well, people have been saying that for a while, but God.
It doesn't make any money.
Yeah, it's got to end soon.
It doesn't make any money. But as long as you have a name and people who are sucker investors to line up, it's just going to keep going.
But the thing about that, though, Gus, is people have been saying it for a while, but Twitter hasn't been around very long either. You know, not
three years?
Well, I'm saying not in the spotlight. It hasn't been around that long.
I see.
People have been saying that about Twitter during its peak. That's kind of weird.
Like, there's nothing that says late 90s to me than like a tech company that people don't quite understand. They know the name. They think it's cool. But yet it doesn't make any money.
Yeah, they have no way to make money.
And they're just like, well, it's I know the name. It's popular. I should invest in that.
Especially if it's a goofy name like Twitter.
Maybe right? We just don't understand it. Maybe it's like another Craigslist where it doesn't have any visible way to make money. And then years down the road, you figure out, oh, they were selling ads in New York all the time.
But he, I mean, he's stated that they're not profitable, right?
Yeah, I think so.
How could they be? What's their source of revenue?
Exactly.
I mean, it's one thing to not be profitable. It's a totally different thing to have no revenue, no money coming in.
I don't know. I think he said that they have some money coming in now, and maybe when you start hearing terms like 2011.
They're looking at some Nigerian investors very seriously right now.
I don't get
some royalty maybe wanting to give them some money. They're trying to work out the details.
Speaking of 2011 and profitability, not to change the subject, but did you guys see that Sony pushed back their profitability forecast to like 2013?
Sony?
Yeah. Does that mean all of Sony?
All of Sony.
Ouch.
Yeah, they're hoping the PlayStation will be profitable by the end of 2010. But Sony as a brand was supposed to be profitable by, I think, 2012, and now they're saying 2013.
Shit, 2012, wow. Huh?
Fucking, yeah.
There was a rumor that IBM was going to halt manufacturing of the Cell processor, and the official press release that IBM put out in response to that was, we'll keep making the Cell processor as long as Sony wants it. So I guess there's no other use for this thing, and that's all they're going to make it for is just for the Sony.
Wow.
That's like the corporate equivalent of you can crash at my place. Things are going hard. You know what? You can just sleep on my couch. That's fine, buddy. We're here for you.
It's kind of reminiscent of Apple when they used the PowerPC chips and Motorola was making them. It was like, yeah, we'll make a few every now and then whenever you need them.
Do you guys want to talk about that copyright, the patent for the podcast? You guys want to talk
about? That we got contacted because I want to hear Joel explain it.
No,
go ahead, Joel. You brought it up.
Yeah, apparently there's these aliens.
There is a company called Volo Media, and we're getting all this secondhand because somebody contacted us. But Volo Media apparently has a patent and has been awarded a patent on podcasting, where there's very specific language in it, something along the lines of it allows people to get a subscription and download regular content based on their subscription to that show.
Right.
And that would essentially be podcasting.
I think they said periodic content.
Periodic, regular content, whatever. You know, episodic content, I think, was in there as well, perhaps. So this company now could then kind of get a stranglehold on the whole podcasting economy.
Oh, no.
Watch out. But it is a pretty far-reaching patent, and it's one of those really scary broad patents. And somebody contacted us because the EFF, which is the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Gus, what is it?
The Electronic Frontier Foundation.
Thank you very much. Apparently, they're looking for someone who was doing this kind of thing before they filed and were awarded their patent, which was sometime in September of 2003. And we've been contacted by some people because we started Red vs. Blue April 1st, 2003, in which we had a subscription model.
Yep.
Unlike a lot of sites, which we go back to Twitter. Why doesn't Twitter offer pro accounts? Why don't they just do that? It's easy. Just people love Twitter so much, you put a little bird by their name, you know?
Give them an extra five characters.
God damn it, you beat me to it.
It's got to be the pattern where it's just like we're going to suck up as many users as we possibly can until we have to throw that down. And then, because that's when you got to start losing people, right?
Right. I guess so. I don't know how you can go into business and do that. Like, how do you just set up that this is what I'm going to do with my life? I'm going to start a business that doesn't really have a value, just so I can sell it to somebody in, like, some kind of weird gotcha moment and, you know, ha-ha, I'm out, see ya. But, you know, in April of 2003, we started offering Red vs. Blue as episodic content, and then later in April, we introduced our sponsorship model, our subscription model, which was actually a paid model, too.
Mm-hmm.
And so they contacted us saying, hey, you guys predate this thing. Would you be interested in helping bust this patent?
Hell yeah.
Why not?
Now, why would we bust it when we can own it? Apparently, we did it first. Every,
yeah, but
this,
we never filed the patent.
We can make the Drunk Tank the only real podcast on the internet. Everyone else is just
people
an imitator.
Would that be great?
You went to iTunes podcast. It was just Drunk Tank, right? Big icon right in the middle. That's
we
it.
Had to like divide up all the responsibilities of all the other podcasts. Like us would have to talk about Harry Potter.
That'd be great.
Yeah, so it's kind of interesting. I'm not a big fan of patents on things that everybody knows about anyway, and just some jackass had the idea, oh, I'm going to fill out the form before anybody else thinks to do it.
I don't know.
What?
I don't know. I mean, I'm sure you would feel different about it if you were the jackass who sort of came up with some sort of technology.
Well,
why wait till the end of 2009 to bring it up?
It's too broad.
Well, maybe,
is the problem.
Maybe this particular jackass is wrong.
This isn't some dude sitting in a lab who came up with this idea of delivering episodic content automatically through the internet. I mean, what the fuck? Everybody knows about that. I mean, it's
so dumb it doesn't need it. Like, I patented breathing. Fuck it. You all can't breathe. You owe me money.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm going to patent holding my breath for 13 seconds. So anybody who does owes me 15 cents. You know? I mean, it's not like, trust me, we talk a lot about piracy. In fact, we caught a lot of shit last week about that we're apparently not PC gamers, that people think that we don't like PC gaming.
We love PC gaming.
I think we've talked about PC gaming more than anything else with the fucking World of Warcraft discussions that Gus always has.
And the fact that we're all going to play Old Republic the second it comes out.
Yep.
I think people confused our hatred of people who whine about irrelevant shit on the internet with PC gaming somehow when we were talking about Modern Warfare 2. Anyway, I lost my own train of thought here. What were we talking about just before this that led to PC gaming?
We're talking about patents.
I was going to say, clearly we like intellectual property. We vocally say how much we don't like piracy. I see the value of patents and allowing people to make money from their intellectual property.
If they're legitimate.
Yeah, but this is not. I mean, this is some guy like, oh, this is something everybody's thinking of. Nobody.
I like all the side businesses that spring up where it's like if something becomes popular, it's like, well, maybe how can we just get Apple to settle?
Yeah.
How can we just get Apple to settle?
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
They have
right.
lots of money.
It's like that. Aren't Nokia and Apple in suing each other right now over some mobile technologies?
I don't know.
I think they're Nokia sued Apple. Apple countersued. It's this whole thing going on now.
TiVo's making a lot of money suing people at this point. And I mean, you could kind of make the argument that they have the ability to do that, but digitally recording video. I mean, once again, is that really that novel of a concept? People were doing that. I was doing that in 1998 when I was making movies.
Hmm. I think the thing they were doing, though, was the whole scheduling thing and having it integrated with programming. So you don't have to, it's not a manual process.
Right, right.
You know you've arrived as a company when you're getting sued by people. This is just how it is.
No, I don't ever want us to arrive as a company.
Not
then.
Entertainment companies, for the love of God.
Good Lord.
What's wrong with you, Joel? Jesus.
I don't know.
Hey, did you hear that jailbroken iPhones got worms again? They got viruses
in Scandinavia, right?
Yep. Apparently, if you have a jailbroken phone, you're susceptible to another virus puts a worm on your screen. That's how you know you have it.
How do you feel about that?
Well, you know, we talked about it once before, where I guess that Dutch hacker was doing this, and he was hacking people's phones. He would lock them out of their phone and tell them if they sent him €5 that he would unlock their phone.
Oh, my God.
I love
bastard.
It.
I love it. I personally, you know, if you jailbreak your phone, fuck you. You know, we're talking about piracy. You're obviously doing this to, you know, circumvent DRM and steal stuff. So you get what you deserve. In fact, I hope Apple's doing this. I hope Apple's writing these viruses.
Really?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
I mean, I don't care about that kind of thing. I mean, that's their if they're using it to get like.
I know someone who has a jailbroken phone. And the reason she has a jailbroken phone, she says she can download all the apps on the App Store for free.
Oh. There you go.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you think about that,
I don't know that person, do I?
Maybe.
At that point, you're not just taking from Apple and AT&T. I mean, the people who make the apps for the store tend to be single programmers working in a bedroom somewhere.
Yeah, like the fucking
making the world's worst fucking programs of all time.
How many apps does this girl have on her phone?
Oh, I don't know. I haven't looked.
Give her the worm.
It's a buck.
That's a nice out of context. Just give her the worm, dude. That'll solve any problem with some.
But yeah, I love it.
Speaking of apps, Foursquare.
Hey, yeah. Do you like that?
I'm in love with it. Yeah.
Yeah, Jeff and I have been looking at Foursquare as an alternative to Twitter. It's like an active version of Twitter, essentially.
What's that? I don't know. I don't even know what that is.
Foursquare is a social networking media community bot thing that you go and download an app for your iPhone. And Jeff, why don't you describe what happens from there?
Well, you download an app from your iPhone.
Okay.
Now, you download this app, and then you turn it on, and it says, hey, do you want to find all your friends using Foursquare? And you say, absolutely. So then I have, like, Bernie and Griffin, and I think Nathan's using Foursquare as well. And then what you do is when you go to a location, like, say we're going to go downstairs to the Hideout to get some coffee, you go to Foursquare and check in and say, hey, I'm at the Hideout. And it lets all of your friends know Bernie's at the Hideout getting coffee. And then it keeps a record of how often you go to places. And if you go to that place more than anybody else, you can become the mayor of the Hideout.
And take it away from somebody else.
So why didn't y'all tell me about this? I see y'all are friends with Nathan now,
huh?
This is
like the perfect stalking tool.
I see what's going
on.
What else are y'all and Nathan doing together?
Nothing.
No, how does it know that you're at the Hideout?
GPS, I guess.
I leave town for like 3 days and look what happens.
Anything that like uses the GPS in the background of your phone and it tells other people, that's a little scary to me.
Hand me my phone, Jeff. I want to show Joel something.
Is there a foursquaring too hard?
No, I don't think there is a foursquaring too hard yet. But I have a Twitter app for my iPhone called Tweety, and one of the weird features of it is that you can just hit a nearby search,
mm-hmm.
and it'll show you all the tweets that happened within a little range on your Google Map.
Yeah, I have Twitterific on my iPhone, and it does the same thing. It shows you, like, by distance, all the tweets going on around you.
I'm currently trying to become the mayor of the liquor store by my house.
Nice.
But someone named Megan K has it right now.
What a drunk.
I hate that shit.
What is that, the Twin Liquors over there?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to fight you for it then.
Okay.
Well, the cool thing about it is that you just say, I'm here, I'm at the teriyaki place, and I hit my button, I check in there, and then it just kind of updates your friends where you are and where you're going and what you've been doing. And there's no, it's more active, whereas I consider Twitter to be very passive, where you just sit and go, thinking about getting up, you know, or whatever people type on there.
Fuck it, I'm downloading it right now.
Could this line at Starbucks be any longer? Like that shit.
Is that our new Twitter voice?
Yeah, that's my Twitter voice.
I think it needs to have more hipsterish to it or something. Like,
I was trying to sound bored and
ineffected. I can't believe I got third row tickets. They're always like, the thing about Twitter that I can't stand is it makes me like people that I know in real life. It makes me like them less.
Sure.
Because it is just this endless stream of weird kind of forced humility, but you're bringing up stuff to make yourself look better.
Like, no one is important enough to use Twitter.
What?
No one is important enough to use Twitter.
You can argue with that. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to know that level.
Maybe the president. Like, maybe the president.
Maybe the president.
It's like taking an old thing, dump. Like everybody puts their pants on one leg at a time, and now here we are in 2009. We get to hear about it every two. I'm going to the bathroom. I'm walking down the hall. I'm drinking a cup of coffee. Yeah.
Well, the retweet feature that they just introduced is really cool, but nobody's using it. And you realize how little people actually retweet.
What's the retweet feature they just introduced?
Well, they kind of just changed it up to where now you can just hit, like, if you said, I can't believe my wife has double D boobs or something like that. Not you. I'm not pointing at anybody in particular.
Nice.
Then you would say, okay, I'm going to retweet this. And it would not make an entry for me. It would just keep it, like, it would keep a tally of everyone who's retweeted it, essentially.
You know, I read that that feature cost $200 million in venture capital. So,
Jesus.
It's pretty crazy.
That's a great investment Tyrell Price has there.
But you know what? It got them 1,000,000% closer to profitability, right?
No, that's a great question. Where is all that money going?
Well, they redesigned their offices.
Recently. Oh, they did post that. They did post that they redid their offices.
They had a big party and redid their offices.
They redid their offices.
They had a gallery of, Jeff and I looked at it, was it 32 photos?
Yeah, it was a bunch.
There was one photo of a desk in their office.
The weirdest thing you've ever seen.
Couches.
Nice.
Common areas, bars and shit.
When you're not making money, you don't have to work. You just go to work to hang out.
Anti-gravity think tanks, that kind of thing.
Well, that company is made for the stock market. It's made to just climb like crazy and then just crash.
So when is their satellite launching?
The Twitter satellite?
Yeah, I mean, come on, they got that much money.
They should get their own extension for domain names. Like, we all have a name. Like, I'd have Bernie.twt or something like that. All
right, let's do it.
And that's how you get to my Twitter account.
They're going to need to raise some more VC.
I saw that Ben, what was it, on Google Wave? Ben, who's our web developer.
Yeah.
It's a website. You know, you have that little part of the form where you can just fill in, hey, my name's Ben King. And, oh, what's your website, Ben King? He wrote twitter.com/Ben or RTBen or whatever it is.
Nice.
So that's his home on the internet, our web developer.
You know, the other day, Jeff and I heard, we were driving home after working and listening to NPR, and we heard a story on NPR about how ICANN is thinking about changing the way you enter domain names into your browser to allow for non-English character domain names.
Non-English character
domain
names?
So you can have, like, Chinese characters dot Chinese characters or Arabic characters dot Arabic
characters. And you could only get to that domain name through that way. It's not like they're aliased or anything. And they say that like the English language has an unfair command over domain names, and that it should be opened up.
So like, so like, you know, Baidu is like a big search engine in China. So to get there, I'm sure they have like their Chinese character equivalent. But if you wanted to go there and you type like Baidu.cn, then you would be taken to like a different English language version of the site, not the actual site they get in China.
Also, interestingly, on that trip home, Gus, you and I have never talked about this, but we were stuck at a light and you and I looked over to the left and we saw a homeless guy drink a bottle of ketchup.
That's true.
Drank an entire, like, he had a big thing of Heinz ketchup with a squeeze bottle, and he just sat down, he picked it up and was like, squeeze.
It's like a baby bottle. You know, he got.
And Austin, I'm hoping it was ketchup.
Dude, I don't care. Whatever it was a big red bottle of ketchup. It's even grosser if it wasn't ketchup.
You don't know. Maybe he had a mouthful of fries, you know?
Bernie, it was crazy.
Bernie just showed me this Foursquare. I got to say,
this
I don't
Foursquare.
Know.
This is the nearby feature of Twitter.
I don't even know. All I know is seems to me, how is Twitter or something else not immediately replaced by a program that has GPS tied into it?
Well, it does. People's phones have it.
The deal is Twitter's also used probably a lot on computers, and computers don't have GPS.
Maybe yours doesn't.
But soon they will.
Because
in other words, what I'm saying this computer moves around a lot. I don't know how GPS isn't tied into, into everything.
Well, we're inside, so GPS wouldn't work here.
What do you mean?
GPS doesn't work here. When you're in here, your iPhone uses cellular tower approximation.
I get that. But I mean, if your computer's in a fixed location.
Well, Joel's saying GPS is going to be everywhere. I'm saying this is never going
to
be here.
But it has the same functionality? Or no?
It sounds like a dumb statement to say GPS is going to be everywhere. It just sounds like a dumb thing to say. I don't know
really?
Why.
Say a lot of dumb things.
KDK in
not,
Austin.
I don't know how it's not incorporated, how it's not going to be incorporated into everything.
I was using my iPhone when I was in North Carolina, and I had no cell phone coverage, but I could get my little blue dot to come up because I could apparently reach the satellites.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, is there an easy way to pull the latitude and longitude information off of your iPhone GPS?
I'm still not convinced that it was actually connected, though.
I had a little blue dot.
Yeah, but
maybe
that blue dot just loads on a blank screen.
It was on a blank screen because I couldn't load the map data.
Yeah, but maybe we should test that further. Like, we should turn off the radio on the phone and then load Google Maps and see what it does. Does it still have a blue dot?
I don't know. That's a really good question. You should do that. how does that work exactly? Is there, like, a little GPS device in here?
I believe so.
That seems weird. GPS seems weird. Okay, you say it can't come in here, but how does it get through the phone? How does it get through my pocket? How does it get through the roof of my car? Is it coming through the windows because the satellites are at angles?
Yeah, they're looking at
on
you.
The horizon? No, I'm asking you a question.
I think so. They come through the windows on angles.
My cat has GPS.
Well, GPS is going to be everywhere.
I truly believe
that. Dogs may not get GPS in the future, but cats definitely will.
No, my cat definitely she has the chip. That's how I was going to find her.
There's a business idea right there. Every
She
service.
Doesn't have GPS.
Your cat does not have GPS.
My cat ate an iPhone. That's what do you think happened to Griffin's iPhone?
Like if you were selling like dog and cat collars that had GPS chips in them.
Wait a minute, Joel.
That's not a great idea, right?
Hold on a second. You're going to be off the hook for the entire podcast. Hold on a second. You really thought your cat had a GPS chip?
No, my cat has the satellite chip.
What?
What?
No, there's no satellite chip in your cat.
Yeah, I had it implanted in her.
No, there's no satellite chip in your cat.
Yeah, we did it at the vet.
No, that's not what that is.
What is it?
That's a chip that if your pet is found, they can scan it and read the information off the chip. It doesn't locate your cat.
This one does.
No, it doesn't, I guarantee. Because that would be the coolest app in the entire world, is to see cat patterns in your city. Like, you could overlay it over Google Maps.
You don't have that iPhone app yet?
No. Listen, your cat does not have a GPS chip.
My cat's got computers in him, I'm telling
you. Your cat is not GPS.
He's got a cybernetic eye.
My cat can upload videos directly to YouTube, just so you know.
My cat aggregates music I like off of iTunes and downloads it for me to my phone.
Did you lose your cat?
Yeah.
Recently?
Thanks to GPS, I found him, though.
Yeah, if you had GPS in your cat, why didn't you use it?
Because I hadn't registered it yet. I hadn't registered the chip yet.
All right, I'm going to look this up. Because you're saying this with such confidence, it makes me think you could possibly have GPS in your cat.
I'm just fucking around.
Have you ever seen the cool camera collars that you can buy for cats?
Yeah, you showed it to me, but cats don't do anything interesting.
No, apparently not.
They just hang out in storm drains all day long.
Man, they're like the perfect users for Twitter then. Yeah. Taking a nap under a car.
Can you show me the video of the cat sitting at home all day long?
I showed you that.
Basically sat there in a chair for 8 hours, didn't move.
Watching a bird.
Thinking about getting some food later. There was a video Joel's talking about is some guy set up a video camera to record what happens in his house when he goes to work, and he wants to see what his two cats do all day long. They literally did nothing all day. It was two cats, and they sat in the exact same spot, and he time-lapsed 8 hours or 10 hours over the course of like a minute and a half. They just sat there the entire day doing nothing.
Nice.
You know, Joe was doing that. Joe was just kind of sitting on those stairs doing nothing.
He'd also sit back here on the couch every now and then and mix it up.
You notice I had to remove all the couch covers.
I did notice that.
Yeah. We're replacing the couch covers on our couch so we can get rid of all the cat dander.
Dander. That sounds like such a dirty word.
Do you think so?
Dander. Ugh, sounds gross.
That doesn't seem gross to me at all.
I don't like it.
You ever heard the expression, "got my dander up"? That sounds kind of creepy, right?
I guess.
I've never heard that. I call it my penis.
Jesus.
See, that sounds dirty to me.
Yeah, now it's dirty. Yeah. Hey, did
you
hear that?
Jeff's has a GPS chip in it.
My penis?
Yeah.
It's boner PS. Did you hear about... You remember a couple weeks ago, right before Modern Warfare 2 came out, Xbox Live banned a whole bunch of people who were playing the game illegally and had pirated it?
Yeah.
Did you hear that they are now mulling a class action lawsuit against Microsoft?
No, they're not.
Yeah, they are.
Interesting.
I guess a law firm is asking for people who got banned to contact them so they can figure out if they have a class action lawsuit on their hands.
This is why I like lawyers. They're always fighting for injustice.
What the fuck? Dude. Intellectual property law firm, Abington IP, I guess is who's trying to organize it.
I like this. I would love to see their side of the argument.
Yeah.
I mean, what is their side of the argument?
Who knows?
Well, I don't think most people realize that when you sign up, that big long list of user agreements that you never read and the end user license agreements, that's an actual contract.
Yeah, they're saying they acknowledge that the bans were a method to combat the legitimate concern of piracy. The firm claims Microsoft could have and should have tailored its punishment more narrowly.
No. I mean,
more narrowly?
Well, the problem is they're going to have to find the guys who were shut off that shouldn't have been shut off. Mm. And I think everything that Microsoft has said, that they take a very wide sampling and then they always scale it back.
Well, here, they're clarifying a little further here. The firm criticized Microsoft for removing functionality not associated with piracy, like Netflix video streaming.
So what?
I know. It's all bundled in.
I just don't get it. It's really weird in this culture when we have people who say Microsoft isn't playing fair when they don't expect to be able to play fair either. You know what
right.
I mean? They want to not play fair, but they want the person on the other side to play fair. It's like, yeah, I was pirating games, but you guys shut off my Netflix. I wasn't even pirating that. I was only pirating your stuff.
Oh, I'd be careful. These guys have offices in Tulsa, Wichita, and Dallas.
Really?
They're huge.
We're going to come to find out they're representing us in a patent lawsuit or something like that.
They list Tulsa first as their first office. Jesus.
If we agree to do this thing and help these people with this damn patent thing, we're not going to go to fucking court and shit, are we?
I hope not. I don't even own a suit.
Man.
I got my dress hoodie dirty. It's got oil stains on it.
Maybe we should just sell our company to that people who want the patent. That would be a faster course of action.
How come we can't find the investor Twitters?
To buy our company? If anybody wants a patent on podcasting, just give us a call.
We'll sell our company for $200 million.
Yeah, we did a valuation on our company. We're
$2
worth $40
billion. No. If Twitter's worth $1 billion, we got to be worth at least like $700 million, $800 million.
Well, don't forget, we now get to include podcasting. So.
Oh, shit, yeah.
That's a pretty big chunk right there.
Right.
Yeah, I'd go for, how much is Facebook worth? Like $3 billion? So we're worth like $5 billion then.
At least. I'm pretty sure we own half of Pixar. Isn't that the way this works out? I'm pretty sure.
Hey, how come no one's playing Left 4 Dead 2?
I'm not playing anything at all.
Why?
I'm just really busy because we're about to purchase a building that we're going to move into. And
Potentially.
I mean, we're going to do something, you know, and the one we're looking at just is eating up a lot of time with me because there's issues with the building. So,
The building has been used as a restaurant, as a restroom for homeless people for the past 6 months, essentially.
Well, yeah, this is a building that needs a lot of work and, well, let's just put it this way. The city of Austin agrees with that assessment. And once the city of Austin, especially the code department, gets involved, then it's just want to make sure we're making the right decision by choosing this particular building.
And we are. If you've played Fallout, then you know what the building looks like.
You know, actually, touring that building is a lot like playing Left 4 Dead 2. It really is.
It is. I don't know how to begin to describe this building.
I've been playing a lot of Left 4 Dead 2, Joel, to answer your original question.
You're the only one.
Yeah, it's a little disappointing. I look at my friends list and I see one or two people playing
with me. I've got like 300 points in it. What are you guys talking about?
Yeah, so do I.
but I only play it at work for videos.
It seems like it's definitely harder than the first one.
I can't play video games at home anymore. I can't play new games at home anymore because if I'm playing a new release, I have to be capturing. Otherwise, mm-hmm. I can miss an achievement video. So instead, I play stuff like Fable 2 at home, which is what I've been playing.
You know what Joel said, though, is there's a lot of complaints about Left 4 Dead 2 being much harder than Left 4 Dead. I mean, serious complaints that the game is not enjoyable because it's so difficult.
Joystick ripped it apart.
It's pretty hard.
It's harder. I haven't had too much more of a difficult time. I just feel like some things are maybe a little more confusing now.
Dark Carnival is harder, specifically.
That last bridge on the last level, I can't remember, but that last bridge where they throw, there's one tank on the bridge, and then there's a second tank by the helicopter. I've played it on normal. I still cannot get on that helicopter.
You should watch my video. I show you how to do it in 2 minutes.
On normal.
With Andrew Panton.
Me, just me and Andrew Panton.
And one of those people being Andrew Panton.
On normal by myself, I think I got through that the first try.
Just kill the two survivors, kill the other survivors so they can't slow you down, and just run on the left side.
No,
ignore the tanks,
I've run on the left side. The thing is that I get into the helicopter, and the tank also gets into the helicopter, and then kills me inside the
helicopter. Never had that problem. I've done it on easy and normal.
With Andrew Panton,
but I mean, we're not shooting.
Does Andrew Panton kill the tanks?
A bank robbery. Yeah. With Superman.
No,
there was nothing.
Watch the video, we're not shooting or anything. We're just running. I don't know if I shot a single zombie.
Tell him to put the money back.
You watch the video. You'll get some awesome tips.
I'll watch the video.
Dude, just say no and then melt their guns.
Duh, heat vision. No, I find Dark Carnival to be really hard. The other campaigns I didn't think were too bad, but Dark Carnival is fucking. They kind of take the fun out of it.
Even the mall, you know, where you have to load the gas cans into the car, I really struggle with that.
There's one level I felt was too long in the mall. It's the one where you have to turn off the alarm when it's going off. I felt like that level stretched on for a long time.
Yeah, I don't know. Sometimes the developers are like, you know, we're just going to make it impossible, and that equals better. Mm.
I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm having a blast with the game. I'm having a lot of fun, but
it is a lot of fun.
Very picky.
I do feel overwhelmed by equipment choices, though.
Yeah, and I felt weapon upgrades weren't as clear. Like, before you had, like, a small rifle, then a bigger, more powerful rifle. Now you have, like, that submachine gun, and then, like, an AK-47 or an M16. Like, there's a few other choices.
Yeah, there's, like, four shotguns.
And when I first started playing, I didn't know which was better or what the differences were. Before, it was just, like, good, better. You know, it was very clear-cut.
It's just a learning curve, you know?
Yeah.
It's the apocalypse, man. What do you want? Not everything's going to be clear-cut when that happens. You've got to be ready to make tough choices.
I've still never seen the goddamn cricket stick. Have you?
Yeah. I've got that.
I saw it once.
I've never gotten it.
I've got that achievement for all the melee kills.
That's the one I need.
Where's the cricket? I found it a lot at the mall level, actually.
Really?
Yeah.
I will say that there's some stuff in there that's really cool, like hard rain, when you have to, like, when the weather gets worse depending on how well you're doing.
Yeah.
And you have to, you go to a point and then
come back.
The weather
is dependent upon how well you're doing in that?
Yeah, supposedly.
That's what I heard.
Supposedly, like, the better you do, the worse the rain is, to make it harder to scale the difficulty for you.
Wow, I've only played that level once, but yeah, you're absolutely right. That rain is fantastic.
It's a ton of fun.
Especially at the end where you're... God, now I'm scared. Are we giving up spoilers? But
at the end
of the beginning where it just turns into just a tsunami. I mean, it's just great.
I love some of the things they did in that game, though. Like, you know, that whole level where you have to go, you know, to a point and then come back.
Yeah.
So you play through everything backwards, and you have to remember where you were.
And you really do have to remember where you were, because coming back, it's confusing as shit.
Yeah, it's funny, because I only played it once, didn't know, and it was like, hey, there's eight health kits in this room. Let's use them all!
It's
kind of difficult on the way back when there's no health kits.
Also, dead center at the very beginning when you're going down the building and you got to run through all the fire and stuff, that was super cool.
I don't know if you've had this dialogue pop up yet, but one time, you know, Ellis is always talking about his friend Keith. One time, Ellis starts talking to the group and says, "Did I ever tell you about the time me and my friend Keith escaped off of a burning building filled with zombies?" Like, oh, wait, that was you guys. Man, I can't wait to tell Keith about that one.
Dude, those speeches, every single speech that Ellis has is awesome.
I'm actually trying to make a video right now of, like, it's Ellis's greatest hits.
It's fantastic. It's fantastic.
He's got a lot of really funny stuff.
So now that you've played Left 4 Dead 2 and you've played Modern Combat 2, which one?
There's definitely more replay value in Left 4 Dead 2.
Really?
I think so.
But you never played multiplayer on Call of Duty, ever.
I played it once or twice. I played
several hours of Modern Warfare 2 before Left 4 Dead 2 came out.
Which
I probably played like 6 hours online.
The problem...
I prefer Left 4 Dead 2.
And it's the same. It's like the exact same...
Yeah, it's pretty similar.
Yeah.
Left 4 Dead 2 is great in that you're forced to play as a team. with other players, and you don't get that experience in a lot of other FPSs for sure. And I don't feel that way when I play Modern Warfare, or even like when I play Halo. Really, I feel that way in ODST, but I like that experience.
I agree with you 100%.
Yeah, and plus there's
no finally a game where it's like you've got to work together as a team. If you don't, there's consequences almost immediately.
Yeah, I don't really work well in teams.
No, you don't. You yell well.
You're good at the
teams.
Yelling part.
You're good at letting us know. The
Everyone,
second
stop
the,
what you're doing. I am tackled. How come you didn't respond in two
the
nanoseconds?
The millisecond a hunter
My
is
God.
On Bernie, your headset is like screaming at you.
Never have you like. Can you grasp how like a person is coming from only their own perspective when you play that game?
Yep. You know what? It's an apocalypse. All that matters is that I survive. That doesn't matter. Everything else, that's it. Who cares?
Hey, let me ask you this, Joel. You've played Modern Warfare 2 now?
Yes.
What did you think of the story?
Yeah, it had some cool turns into it. It's funny because last time we talked, it was just right before that crazy turn at the end, which I liked. But the one thing about it is that it has, you know, the gameplay's so gritty and awesome. And then they have a story which is a little bit ridiculous.
Yeah.
And a little confusing. And I'm not sure where they're going with it. You know?
Yeah, I agree. And I don't like the setup for the next game.
Yeah, I thought Jeff's reaction to the big plot twist where the general turns out to be the bad guy was the best reaction. Because Jeff says, you know, I was in the military. I know a general would never be on that plane out on the battlefield like that. The second I saw him, bad guy.
Yeah, that's the first thing I thought. Like, when he gets off that plane to hold your hand after you go through the house level where you have to defend the house against the Russians. And, like, the general comes out and he goes, good job. And I was like, I'm about to get fucking capped. There is no way a general is going to be on a fucking helicopter in the middle of Russia. He would be in the Pentagon, 17 feet of concrete above him. This just doesn't happen. It's fucking bullshit. There'd be some perennial light colonel who is an awesome dude who spends his entire life in the field who can never get promoted because he's in the field constantly. There's no way. No way.
I'm just coming from like a story point of view, and it's just like how are they going to pay this off at the end?
I don't know. Well,
yeah, they definitely left it kind of opening on a left it open on a cliffhanger.
The thing that worries me is they leave it open for a very Splinter Cell type next game where Soap and what's his face Price are now going to be like renegades.
Yeah,
and they're going to have like less equipment.
Yeah,
because they don't have access to all the all the resources, and it's going to go like that doesn't seem cool. I feel like that's been done.
I absolutely agree.
I hate to sound like a negative because I really like the game. The game it doesn't matter. The story, ultimately, a game like Modern Warfare, the story doesn't matter because the game is so much fun to play.
And ultimately, really, how they rank the game is, well, will Jeff and Joel buy the next one?
Right, true.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. I'll still be out there for the midnight launch.
Yeah.
So.
We're just nitpicking fans. You know, we're fans of the game. We like it. Got a
absolutely. Yeah.
I've heard some really crazy stuff about Assassin's Creed 2 as well.
Oh, have you?
I just have heard that it's really great. I haven't had a chance to play it. Have you?
No, I haven't. Well, I played a little bit when we were making the commercial for it, you know, but I didn't want to get too far into it because I wanted to
have
a full experience.
You guys played the first one, right?
Yeah, for sure.
See, everything I'm hearing about the second one, and I guess there's a twist there at the end as well, but it also feels really the same as the first one, too.
Oh, really? That wouldn't bother me. I don't think I like the first one enough, but I did read that it sold 1.3 million copies its first week.
Oh, that's good.
Which is pretty good.
Yeah.
I would think.
It's no Twilight.
It's no New Moon.
How much money did New Moon make?
Was it the third all-time?
Third highest opening week.
Number
ever.
One single day. Number one midnight opening. Come on in, Jack. And then it was third highest of all time. Hey, do you want to weigh in, Jack, real quick on tell us a little bit about Assassin's Creed 2? Why don't you take Jeff's mic over there? Here.
Sure, I'll talk about Assassin's Creed 2. What do you want to talk about?
Well, I just heard it's crazy. I mean, everything I'm reading about it, people are just loving it. Without giving too many spoilers, because it's a pretty new game.
That's sort of the issue. Okay, without saying any spoilers, the end of the game is fucking crazy. Like, literally, the character on screen goes, "What the fuck?" And which is exactly what I was thinking as it was going. I didn't play the first one at all, but I've heard the first one's kind of messed up, too. But the story in this one, it's really good, actually. I really dug it.
Yeah? Does it make you want to go back and play the first one so you have a frame of reference?
Kind of, yes. But I've heard the first one gets real repetitive. I'm not sure how true that is, but yeah.
Assassin's Creed 1 is what Modern Warfare 2 is. It's the same sort of thing, where so many stories is like, hi, I'm the guy who's going to teach you and show you, and I'm going to be your, you know, I'm going to show you and blah, blah, blah. And at the end, guess what? I'm your enemy.
So you just spoiled the first game for me.
Yeah. And the first Batman movie, too.
Sorry he spoiled the 2-year-old game for you. That sucks.
I hope you learn how to cope, Jack.
Oh, thank you. Well, no, but the thing about Assassin's Creed, well, goddamn, I can't, I don't want to spoil it.
All right, get
anything,
out of here.
So
yeah, don't spoil
it.
Get out of here. So
right.
You say thumbs up, definitely.
Thumbs up, definitely check it out. It's a great it's a great single player game, which you don't get a whole lot of lately.
So they updated the zombie outbreak simulator. Did you guys see that?
No.
No, the one we linked a couple weeks back?
We linked that one, the old one with just the green dots and the purple squares.
One.
Now they did it with Google Maps, to where you can go around like a Google map of a city and see the zombie outbreak taking place.
Nice.
And you can change the starting factors, like how
so
many zombies you start with.
What you're saying is in the future, zombies will have GPS.
What I'm actually saying is that GPS is going to be everywhere, and
there's no application that where GPS isn't practical. Zombies.
The GPS company, GPS Incorporated, should come up with that as their slogan, Joel. GPS.
Are you heavily invested in GPS, Joel?
Do
you have a secret agenda here?
It's true. It's like the knife that I use to stab everyone in this room will have a GPS on it. That way you'll know where you are.
GPS. It's going to be everywhere.
The ambulance can get to you quicker.
Hey, you can modify on the new zombie outbreak simulator. You can modify your starting settings. You can have number of civilians, what percentage of those civilians are armed. We'll have to jump that up for living in Texas. Civilian accuracy, number of zombies as you start with, which direction the zombies are moving. Oh, you can set zombie speed, and your three choices are slow, normal. I would argue that normal is slow, and fast.
Fuck
very
fast.
Very fast. They have a very fast setup. Ugh. Give me a break.
Hey, speaking of zombies, I just read this morning that there is a new startup that's making a zombie MMO for consoles.
That sounds incredibly awesome.
Yeah.
That is an MMO that I will play.
Yeah, and it's for consoles, too, which makes it even better.
How does that happen? How does that work, though? Like, is it zombies versus survivors? And if a zombie kills a survivor, does that person become a zombie of equivalent level?
It might just be player versus environment.
Still not sure why it's like Grand Theft Auto doesn't just take that huge asset, that huge map, and just turn it into, like, a giant zombie zone where you can have just a couple players jump in there and have it be a giant zombie city. How hard would that be?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't make Grand Theft Auto. It's hard for me to say how hard that would be.
That'd be cool.
I don't know.
You know what I heard about zombies? They're going to be everywhere.
It's almost going to be disappointing.
I fucking hope not.
This computer's going to have a zombie in 5 years. Just watch.
Only if you jailbreak it, though.
Hey, did you hear that that Boeing's testing some new like laser defense systems on airplanes?
Fuck. Okay, about that then, because I saw a thing where they're testing offensive weapons on planes.
Yeah, a couple weeks ago, I think we talked about this in the podcast, didn't we? You brought it up.
I showed it to you, but we never talked about it.
Oh, okay. Well, you talk about yours first, because this came after that. This is like an offshoot of what you have.
Well,
to
yours
say.
Thing sounds like a defense where they're going to do what? They're going to knock missiles down that are
right. They fill a plane with lasers, and then that plane can then shoot down other planes and missiles in midair.
Fill a plane with lasers.
Now, and in addition to lasers, it also has machine guns.
Well, wait a minute. You're talking about Boeing. Boeing makes commercial airliners,
right?
Well, they're not
some,
military.
They make some military.
Well,
like,
they do.
These people, like the contacts for the story, they're titled. They're with the Boeing Missile Defense Systems Group.
Okay.
So I guess they do other stuff as well. But yeah, they're doing, I guess they have lasers and machine guns in these planes and they shoot down everything.
Fuck yeah, that's awesome.
It seems like in the current environment, you'd want lasers and machine guns inside the airplane, not outside. But
fuck
yeah. Who am I? I'd
want to be in one of those planes. You have to be like, this is the captain speaking. We're fifth in line for takeoff. Now we're number one. Everybody else dead.
It says that this system they developed used a single high-brightness laser beam to shoot down 5 UAVs at various ranges. It's called the Laser Avenger.
Dude, I love the future. No, that's kind of scary. This thing is really scary. And we'll post this in the linked up so you can see the video of it. This is a sniper plane. It is a plane that has a laser that can shoot you on the ground. And even though the plane is traveling at 500 miles an hour, the computers can change the trajectory of the laser and zap you. Look what it does to this truck.
That's fucking crazy, dude.
The sound you're hearing is a truck hood being burned. It's hitting a square about 1 foot square, a taped square, on the hood of a Ford truck. And it's just incinerating the metal. So imagine that's a person.
And that's going 500 miles an hour while it's doing it?
Yeah.
That's not cool.
From an altitude of like 40,000 feet.
Dude, talk about assassinations.
All I can think is when we're playing Call of Duty 7, we're going to totally get to use that. It's going to be awesome.
Fuck, dude, that's scary. They should put that on boats, right? Am I the only one?
What the fuck?
Because the pirates, dude.
Oh yeah, that's a good call.
Fucking, why don't we defend up our boats so people stop getting fucking hijacked?
Well, I don't think, I mean, you don't have to specifically say put it on boats. I mean, I think they should just bundle it with GPS and it'll end up everywhere.
I knew it. I was counting down. I was going five,
your iPhone,
four.
I hear the iPhone 4GS will have that.
Hey, what do you guys, this has nothing to do with lasers, but what do you guys want to eat for lunch today?
See a Twitter, I'm getting burned by a laser. This sucks.
Here are my coordinates. There is a zombie here, too.
Oh, look, on Foursquare, Jeff just checked in at the morgue.
I
want to do, like, performance art with Foursquare. I just want to, like, check into strip clubs and graveyards. That's all I do all day long.
I'm going to become the mayor of my toilet.
Did you see that bomb-proof wallpaper stuff the other day?
Yeah, I did.
I don't know if I showed that to everyone, but someone developed, like, this single sheet of wallpaper that you can put on walls that makes them explosion-proof, essentially. To where, like, they can withstand a wrecking ball or, like, projectiles.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy.
A single sheet of, like, super thin Kevlar.
I still think it's horseshit.
They showed the demonstration.
Yeah, listen. You could have a wall. It's so paper. It has to be fastened to something. If the building falls down, the wallpaper is not going to keep the structural integrity of the building.
Yeah, but it'll protect the rest of the building. Like, yeah, maybe that wall will fall. But
what happens when you're in the building when it's getting hit by...
Yeah, but like, let's say we're on this side of the building, and then there's a bomb out in the street. Yeah, maybe the front of the building might crumble, but we'll still be safe back.
You're not going to get hit by a brick in the face.
You're not trying to protect the building. You're trying to keep yourself from dying, I think, is the idea.
Right. Yeah. And then, like, in the video, they show it like a wrecking ball hitting this wall multiple times. And yeah, I agree with Bernie. It looks like maybe structural integrity isn't that great afterwards, but...
Who gives a...
It's a hell of a lot better than not having it.
It saves you from a blast.
Yeah, see, I'm not buying it, because it's like, if without the wall, it's... Like, that wallpaper there, they're showing this wrecking ball hitting this cinder block wall, and this wallpaper is keeping this thing up. But the wallpaper is fastened to something at the top and bottom of that wall.
No, that's just where they're securing the wall.
Right, exactly. That's what I'm saying. So,
it's just
without that stuff at the top and the bottom, the whole thing is just going to fall down.
No, it's not the stuff that you see at the top and the bottom is what's holding the wall there. The wallpaper is like adhesive and sticking to the wall.
That's the point I'm making, is that if the building starts to fall down from the strength of this bomb, the wallpaper is not going to keep the whole building up.
Nobody's saying saving the building from destruction. It's just keeping shit from flying at you so you can hop out a window.
Or so that not everyone in the building dies.
Right.
Yeah, maybe the people standing by that wall, maybe the building collapses on them, but the people standing a few feet away, they're still okay.
Yeah, they're in a different building that's collapsing.
Why did that wall just crumple? I gotta get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. All right, well, you don't ever have to use it. Or imagine if it was in a car, you know, for security reasons. You can make secure cars that are a lot lighter.
I like that he believes that a plane flying 500 miles an hour can fucking shoot with pinpoint accuracy on the top of a car, but he has trouble with bomb-proof wallpaper.
I just want to see the laser plane shoot the wallpaper wall.
That's a great experiment.
Let's do that.
There you go.
If the wallpaper had GPS, it can find it more easily.
GPS, they're everywhere.
They're going to bury this, too. I keep hearing it. At least we found something to replace the gay jokes.
The other day, actually, yesterday, I...
We've been saying old jokes lately.
The doorbell rang, and... Brandon didn't go down and get it. I thought that was really weird. I was like, don't worry, Brandon. Stay seated. I got it. Take a load off. And I went down and answered and got the UPS. And last night, I realized that the reason he didn't go down the stairs and answer the door is that he had fucking surgery on his leg on Friday.
Yeah, knee surgery.
Yeah, I didn't realize it.
It was pretty funny when you found that, too, because you were so compassionate. At about 5:15 yesterday afternoon, you looked at Brandon and said, what the fuck is wrong with you?
I love the idea that Gus gets to crack jokes about having to answer the door, too. It's like, oh, don't get up, Brandon. It's like, how about you don't get up, Gus? You haven't answered the door in a year and a half.
You haven't answered the door the whole time we've been here.
I work in the back room.
Whatever.
I mean, Gus is the guy who, after a vacation, takes a personal day to work shit out.
I still have to answer the back door. You sit closer to that.
Gus, what is that? Why, when you take a week-long personal vacation, do you need a day off from work after a vacation?
I've never taken a day off after a vacation. Name one time.
I don't want to name one time.
I'm with Gus on this.
Name one time.
Usually after Gus.
No, I'm asking for one instance. Name one time.
Any time. I would say it's enough to where it's a trend.
I've never taken a vacation, then an extra personal day. I've gone on work trips like Comic-Con and then taken a personal day afterwards.
And then you have a day where you have to work stuff out.
Yeah, that I'll admit to, because that's a work trip. But after a vacation, that's bullshit. I've never done that.
I can say. Like the time you went to Miami, you did that.
I never went to Miami.
I went to Miami.
Jeff, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I can see you getting mad, and I don't want you getting mad at
me. No, because I've never done this.
Jeff, do you want to back me up on this?
I listen.
Name one time. I'm still
with you because it's listen. Like we'll work a week, and it's like, okay, we have to travel, and we have to leave on Thursday. Okay, so we jump on the plane with Thursday, and then we travel throughout the entire weekend. You know, and we're working the whole weekend, and it's like, what? How come you're not back on Monday? It's Monday.
Well, let me clarify something. When you work with your friends, this is the one detraction. It doesn't matter what you actually do or don't do. It just matters what everyone else's opinion of what you do or don't do
is.
It's
all perception.
And I don't know how many times I've put up with you guys thinking, this is what Bernie does, and this is Bernie's thing, ha-ha. And I have to put up with that. I've been putting up with that for 13 fucking years.
That was his Gus voice, by the way.
Right. I don't know. I have no idea what you're talking about right now. You totally lost me.
This is my impression of Gus tweeting this.
I hate Twitter. Bernie does stupid stuff in the office.
I can sense a lot of hurt feelings coming on, and I don't think we should go that route.
Well, his free days have been exposed now, and now he's embarrassed by it. Now,
you still can't name one time.
I love
that's
you.
All I'm asking for. Name one time that happened.
The last time you took a vacation.
When was the last time I took a vacation?
I don't know. I don't know. I really don't know.
When was the last time you took a vacation?
The last time I took a vacation was the first week of September. I took the week off, and then I came back on Monday.
Where'd you go?
I didn't go anywhere. I stayed in town.
How was that?
It was all right.
I'd like to do that. I'd like to take an in-town vacation.
You're probably getting the example of when you took a week off to buy your house, which I think I can come up with about 45 personal days that have come up since purchasing the house.
God. That's a different story. But I don't take the whole day off. I'll run to the house and deal with some bullshit and come back.
You should use that wallpaper on your house.
Yeah, I should use that wallpaper on Bernie's face when I hit it with a wrecking ball.
In Gus's defense, too, apparently any time his in-laws have to leave the house, it requires Gus to help them.
In Gus's defense, apparently every time he goes on a commercial shoot or anywhere for work, it's considered a vacation and I just never realized it.
You know the FAA levied its first fine against an airline for keeping people on a tarmac for 6 hours?
Really?
Well, that shit's out of control, dude.
What airline was it?
It was Continental. And they had to sit on the tarmac. This happened in August. They had to sit on the tarmac for 6 hours, and the FAA fined a levy of $100,000. And guess where the $100,000 goes?
To the FAA.
Not to the people who were sitting in the plane.
Of course not.
Where did it go?
If they keep me sitting on a plane for 6 hours, I don't really want any money. I just want to know that somebody's going to lose money at that point.
I agree with that.
Like, no, I'd be okay with jail time.
I agree with that, too, but...
If a fucker goes to jail for robbing you, he doesn't come to your house and work at your house.
What's $100,000 to Continental Airlines? What's $100,000 to Continental? It's nothing.
I don't know.
I guess it's a start.
That's like 1% of the value of Twitter, from what I heard. Was that a pause because everybody's checking my math or something? I pulled that out of my ass. I'm not sure it's actually 1%.
So. No, I don't think it is.
I think it's a tenth or a hundredth of a percent.
I was hanging on Joel's every word. I was waiting to see what was next.
Interesting stuff.
I mean, there's. If you've ever been stuck on a tarmac, what's the longest you've ever been stuck on a tarmac, Gus?
I think I was once stuck for 4 hours in Kansas City.
By the way, that counted as a vacation day for you. Just so
you know. That's the personal day.
That's the personal day. It's the time of sitting.
So mad. I'm so
I
mad.
Totally agree with you. I totally agree with him. I remember in August I worked like 3 weeks straight because it just there was not a single day off. I was like, why is there no time off? 3 weeks in summer.
Well, if you need a day.
You asked me a question and I gave you a specific example. How long were you you waited on a tarmac? 4 hours. I ask you and you're like, all the time. The last one. The last trip. That's the last time I was on a tarmac. It's called logic. It's called example.
Gus, this might surprise you. I have no idea when you've taken vacation.
Apparently you do, because I always take personal days. I thought we took the phones out.
Yeah, Jeff was supposed to take the phones out.
Gus, answer the phone in your current state. Go ahead.
What?
Another thing that always happens with vacation days around here, since I'm throwing people under the bus, let's bring Jeff in. Jeff's favorite thing to do is walk on the office and tell you how long it's been since his last vacation.
I don't do that.
I do that too.
I don't do
I
that.
I do that too. And it's been a goddamn long time.
And all I ever tell people when they tell me that, they go, man, I haven't taken a vacation for a year and a half. It's like, well, what about the time you went to Miami 2 weeks ago? Before that, it's been 3 years.
I agree that happens, but I'm not the one that does it.
And the response to that is always, take a fucking vacation. Nobody gives a shit. Use your vacation days.
Apparently, Bernie gives a shit. He's counting them every time Gus takes one.
No,
I see him. He's got a fucking
I don't want to get on sides here. I don't want to. There's hurt feelings.
It's true. God. It's so true.
This fucking podcast is going down. Fuck it.
Take a vacation. Why not?
No, apparently, apparently you don't take vacations, and you take vacations anyway.
Just include your personal day, like when you get back on a Friday, and then you have Saturday and Sunday, and you need to take off Monday to take care of stuff. Just include that as part of your vacation.
I haven't had a day off. I don't think anyone does since last Christmas.
Take a vacation, then. You're leaving tomorrow.
I'm leaving tomorrow.
You're doing the thing everybody's complaining about.
I'm not complaining about it. We should do it more. We should complain more.
Here's the bottom line. When you walk around talking about, oh, I haven't taken a vacation, whatever.
And we make that sound, too. We go, oh.
Well, oh. I can't make the sound that people make when they make it. It's like real life Twitter. The bottom line is no one else cares. I mean, I'm not talking about you guys. I'm talking about if you work in a corporate environment, no one else is paying attention to the fact that you're not taking vacation.
I agree with that.
The bottom line is just take your vacation.
They only pay attention when you take the vacation.
Right.
I don't know about that. I think you pay attention. You have a notebook?
I find the personal day...
You make stuff up, though.
I find the personal day after vacation to be funny. I find that funny.
I find it funny because it doesn't exist. That's the funniest part.
Jeff, speaking of vacation, I think after this podcast, we should all take the rest of the day as a vacation.
Okay, let's remove Gus.
It's going to be a long
one. Let's remove Gus from the equation. Just Gus, okay?
Okay.
Just Gus. Does the personal day after vacation exist?
It depends. What do you mean?
Does it exist? The phenomenon on the top of where people take a personal day. Remove Gus.
No, I'm removed. I'm not saying anything.
Yes.
It exists.
Sometimes.
So I'm not crazy.
In my head, it exists. Okay. Yes. My perception is that it exists.
And it could be you, too.
It could be me. It could be me. I think it's Brandon, but it could be me.
Well, Brandon's personal days are apparently to get surgery. Who the hell knew?
Do we get a personal day after this podcast?
Gus, I just want you to go have fun. I'm sorry I brought it up. Yeah. I mean that.
Yeah, go fuck yourself. I mean that. Stick a broom handle up your asshole.
I mean
it. Whoa, this isn't a New York State prison. Come on.
Once again, why do we specifically say asshole again? It's enough to just say ass, guys. Kick your ass. Shove a broomstick up your ass. We don't need to go all the way to asshole.
Maybe we do.
I'm going to fuck your duodenum. All right, I'm out. I'm done. I'm sorry I brought it up. I hope everyone takes a very long vacation.
What a great way to kick off Thanksgiving, huh?
Including your personal days.
Hey, are you making jalapeno turkey this year, Bernie?
Okay, that was a big debate that my wife was talking to me about. I don't have the stuff to make that anymore because my jalapeno turkey that I make was a deep-fried turkey.
Yeah.
Where I would fry it in like 5 gallon...
Oil. You know what some of the best internet videos are? The people trying to deep fry turkeys.
Oh, yeah,
And watching the fires.
But it's worth the risk because when they pull it off, it's like,
it's pretty scary.
I've never had one.
Bernie's deep fried jalapeno turkey is honestly one of the best things I've ever eaten.
Okay, because you said that, really I will go out and buy the stuff and make it.
You know, I don't want to put you out, but it's
should.
Like,
it sounds
and I don't want the blame when you knock it over on your leg and fucking burn yourself to death.
It does scare me.
It is scary. But they're have you ever had them?
It sounds like the greatest thing I've ever heard in my
life.
Dude,
it's like so juicy and crispy.
Fried jalapeno turkey.
It's not what you think, though. It's not like, it doesn't seem like a fried chicken. It's not like a huge fried chicken.
Yeah, it's not like battered. And
yeah.
There's a reason I've spent like 6 Thanksgivings at your house. That reason is the turkey.
All right. All right, I'll do it. But look, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to need a personal day.
So are you going to Bernie's? Are you going to Bernie's for Thanksgiving?
I am now.
What are you doing for Thanksgiving, guys?
Bring some leftovers.
Hosting my in-laws.
Oh, shit. Which ones?
The only in-laws I have.
Okay, not your secret Eskimo family in-laws? No.
You've been playing too much Fable, too. I will bring... You know, I actually used to bring, when we worked at the other company, and I was president of that company, I would bring Thanksgiving dinners to both those call centers for the guys who had to work on Thanksgiving.
Yeah, I remember that.
Do you think they still do that?
No, probably not.
I hope they do.
They probably buy like a Luby's turkey or something, I bet.
Yeah, we would load that place up with tons of food.
Yeah.
You know where you can buy a turkey from? I bet it's pretty good. It's Hoover's. They sell Thanksgiving turkeys.
Hmm.
Pre-made. You should look into that because you're addicted to that place.
They also sell pies. You know, have you seen like when they sell pies at Thanksgiving at Hoover's? They're so popular, they don't sell them at Hoover's. They sell them at the parking lot across the street.
Is that true?
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Hoover's, by the way, is a local Austin restaurant.
It's really polarizing. People love it or hate it.
People hate it? We hated it at first,
I know a lot of people
I think we hated it because we hated the guy who introduced us to it.
I had a bad first experience there.
I had a bad first experience, too, but I've been 2 or 3 times since with Gus, and it's been great every time. Although, one time I ate there, and I thought I was going to die.
Of sickness?
No, just of, like, grease and bad-for-you food.
It's really, like, what do they call that?
Comfort food? Comfort food, yeah.
It's like
it's heavy.
You know, like, we went down to Buda because we're looking at buildings. One of the buildings drew us down to Buda, and we got to eat at Garcia's.
Oh, you nice.
Eat
at Garcia's?
Did you get Norteña's or chicken fried chicken?
It was Garcia's. Is the one restaurant that was across the street from our office in Buda. There was Garcia's, and then there was this place called Two Mamas, which was two ladies who ran a restaurant together. It's now closed, but the best part about that place was you couldn't order anything. You just walked in, and whatever they were serving that day, that's what you ate.
Yeah,
basically. But we went to Garcia's, Matt and I did, and we had our Garcia's chicken, which is awesome.
But Garcia's chicken fried chicken topped with queso has got to be one of the best things.
It's awesome.
Ever.
That and the Norteñas were both awesome.
Dude, the Norteñas are like, it's simultaneously the best and worst thing you can do to yourself.
The weird thing is sometimes it's not spicy. Like sometimes you'll eat the whole plate and like, okay, none of that was spicy. And then the next plate you get, every single bite is death.
These are fajitas that are essentially made with, I think, 3 or 4 fresh jalapenos cut up and just mixed in there.
Talk about assholes, too.
Jesus Christ, man.
Seriously, dude. You shit fire for like 6 hours after that.
You know, I have never had that phenomenon that people talk about.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Never had that.
Wow. You can feel it happening as you eat.
You haven't lived.
Like it's traveling.
I might be some kind of superhero. Very, 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 very specific superpowers. But, yeah, so it's just like a jalapeno. We make those whenever we have barbecues.
Yeah.
We use Jeff's recipe, which I have completely now absorbed, where it's just a fresh jalapeno with cheese in it and then wrapped in bacon.
Yep.
And you just eat that, like a whole jalapeno.
Are really hit or miss. I mean, like, you just don't know.
Spice-wise.
Spice-wise.
Joel literally had to go to the bathroom and cry at my house one time.
We all stood
around and just watched him. It was the funniest
thing. And everyone was like, no, it's fine. It's fine. See? And then they take a bite out of it. And you could clearly just see the twitching eyes. It was bad.
It was funny.
It is. The jalapeno is like the Russian roulette of the pepper world.
It's true.
It is.
Because sometimes you will just get super mild ones, and the hottest pepper I have ever eaten in my entire life was a jalapeno.
And there's no rhyme or reason. It doesn't correlate to size or color or anything. It's just totally hit or miss.
But everyone has theories as to why it is. Like, you'll be with people like, see this dent on the front? That means it's a female jalapeno. That
I've never heard that.
Isn't there a correlation with the seeds?
It's the jalapeno vagina.
I don't think it's the seeds. I think it's actually the webbing.
Membrane.
Yeah, the membrane.
The membrane.
That's what they say, but who knows?
Man, but I one time on a hunting trip, I bit into a jalapeno. We had hatch peppers and jalapenos, and we were just eating them, and all of a sudden one guy was like, whoa, and he was, you know, holding his nose, and he was crying, and I was like, what's wrong? Because he was from Arkansas. I said, you can't take a hot pepper? He goes, he was laying on the table, he goes, that is a hot pepper. I go, how hot can it be? He goes, tell you what, buddy, take a bite, you don't think it's hot. I could not breathe. I really, for a minute, I thought I was going to die, because I couldn't breathe. And I just took one little bite out of it, and it was death.
Was it raw, just fresh pepper? Or
it was raw, just like, wow. Like out of the produce bag, you know, from HEB or whatever, from the grocery store. It's just, pick it up, bite, and then just hold your face and hope you don't die or light on fire.
It's like the first time I ate the man up in Seattle.
Another great out of context quote.
I thought I was close to having people take me to the hospital. It was like, oh my God, that's terrible.
You're gonna have to explain what the man is.
That made me
The man is I guess there's this barbecue place in Kirkland called Dixie's Barbecue, and you can go there and they have a special hot sauce that they call the man. And the owner will walk around with a little saucepan filled with the man, and he'll ask all the patrons, have you met the man? Have you met the man? Huh. And if you haven't met the man, he'll get a toothpick and dip like a tiny little droplet. Like, I don't even want to say a drop. A drop is too much. He'll dip like a droplet, like a tenth of a drop on the tip of the toothpick and say, here, try it. And it's the hottest thing you've ever eaten in your life.
It's no joke. That toothpick can ruin your entire day.
I'm surprised the toothpicks don't catch fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, like in the cartoon where they stir the potion with the metal spoon and it comes out, it's all burned.
Yep.
That's what you expect that toothpick to look like.
And the man is like no light escapes it. It's like a black hole. It's so dark. I've never seen like a black hot sauce like that before. And it's just like a mass of seeds and it's kind of thick and weird looking.
Yep. And it's in this little, he's got one saucepan that he carries around and serves this. You can't actually order it at the counter. You just order your food and maybe this guy will walk around with the saucepan asking. Mm-hmm. If you want to try it. And then there's all these newspaper articles on the wall. And
all the people who died.
Well, they're all yellow with age. They're all like these old reviews of the restaurant because it's in an old gas station. And some of these articles look like they're from 1965 because they're so old. but the dude and the pan are in the photos, and they look exactly the same. It's like something out of The Shining. It's like he hasn't aged. He's got this pan. He walks around. You want to meet the man?
And ironically, the man looks like it was drained out of like a 1965 Buick and put into a pot.
And then if you ask the guy, you know, have you ever tried the man? He goes, no, I'm not stupid.
Yeah.
It's brutal. It's probably the most brutal thing I've ever eaten.
Yeah. It's really rough.
And we try to eat it every time we go, you know?
Yeah, I don't get it. I mean, why don't we just walk, start a restaurant, and we'll just have a guy walk around with, like, a bucket of thumbtacks. Here, want to try it? Come on, flavor. Thumbtacks. No, but I don't get it.
And that place also has some of the slowest service. Like, it's like the soup Nazi in Seinfeld.
It definitely
like,
is.
I've been there waiting at the register to order, like, to pay for my food before. And, like, the woman at the register is obviously, like, talking to her doctor or refilling prescriptions. And the line is just, like, getting super long. And they're only open for, like, an hour and a half.
And she's battling with, like, the pharmacist on the other end of the line.
They're always getting
into
fights with each other, too.
And I'm just standing there with my money. Like, the soup Nazi, just like, please finish ordering your pills so I can pay you and eat my food.
Yeah, I don't get it. And people love that stuff. People love it. Like, where people open restaurants, is like, haha, our funny thing is we're going to treat you like fucking shit. And people are like, yes!
With these people,
it's treat like shit. Awesome.
With these people, it's not an act, though. I feel like they genuinely hate everyone.
Oh, yeah, no.
There's no joy in that place. The man sucked it all out.
I'm with Joel, though. I hate that philosophy.
Yeah,
it works.
Nope. There was a place in Austin that had that, and when they went out of business, I was so happy.
What place was it?
GM Steakhouse. And I like GM Steakhouse. I just hated that philosophy of mean service.
You know, that guy that ran GM Steakhouse was always really nice to me. He liked my ex-wife, and it was like the only person in the world that liked her. But
he
like, we would come in,
your ex-wife?
And he would come up and give her a hug and like go down and put it. He was like super nice.
He would give her a hug and go down?
Well, I was just going to like sit us down and give her a hug. And like, what do you guys want today? And
no,
was, like,
did I hear
super
that wrong?
No, that's what he said.
I don't know. Like, I've heard that about that guy before, too. But I had such a different experience. It was really weird.
I never had a problem there. I probably only ate there two or three times ever, but...
It was the location on the drag, which was probably predates you guys.
I'm talking about the one at 6th and Lamar.
The original one, yeah.
Yeah.
The little one where it's like that little metal and glass door, and it's a space that could only be made for a diner because it's so long and thin, and they just have a counter on one side. That's the one you're talking about, right?
Yeah, yeah. Have you been to the new place there?
No.
I can't think of what it's called. Counter Cafe?
I haven't been there.
It's pretty good.
I haven't been there since Rito's closed.
I never got to go there. We're talking about food places that nobody cares about on the podcast.
That was a weird thing. I'm just going to mention it real fast. That was like G&M Steakhouse during the day. Then they closed like at 8 p.m. or whatever. Then from 10 p.m. to 4 a.m., it was a different restaurant called Rito's that served like little hamburgers.
There was a period in there as well where it was a faux restaurant.
Yeah, then I think after Rito's got kicked out, then it was a faux restaurant.
It was really bizarre. Bizarre place.
I feel obligated now to come up with something to talk to Gus about. So that I can mend fences before he starts to edit the podcast.
Just so you know, I'm taking this, you know, the rest of the week off for Thanksgiving. Then I'm taking Monday off too because that's my extra personal day after.
You know what?
Vacation.
That sounds fine to me, Gus. That's totally acceptable. Gus, I was thinking about you the other day because they just had the 4th anniversary for the Xbox 360. Just hit its 4th birthday.
Oh yeah, mm-hmm.
Which was really the 4th anniversary of Zero Hour.
It's the 4th anniversary of my hoodie.
Yeah. Oh, you have your hoodie here. Perfect. Yeah.
It's seen better days. I think this is the last winter it's going to have.
Let me see it. They gave away these hoodies at Zero Hour, which was the launch event for the 360. These are probably the best constructed garments I have ever seen in my entire life.
It's great, except right here, like at the neck, it's starting to unravel
a little
bit.
It's been 4 years.
It's been 4 years, and by the way, you wear that thing all the time.
I've worn that thing every winter for 4 years.
Not all the time. I can't come up with specific examples, but I've seen you wear it in the past.
I'm wearing it right now.
Jeff can back me up on that.
I like you both.
How dare you, sir?
But I wear mine all the time, too. I'm not too big on zipperless hoodies, which is what it is, but I just can't believe how good a garment that thing is.
No, it's awesome.
It's outlasted every 360, I think.
Yeah, I was going to make a joke.
It's never red ring.
Yeah, no red rings on those.
You know what, really, in thinking about the Zero Hour event, which they held in the Mojave Desert about a day before the 360 launch. It was like the evening before, right?
Yeah, it was November 21st to 22nd. Yeah.
I got my first achievement there, by the way. Because they gave us memory cards, and then we were able to get our gamer tags transferred to 360 gamer tags there at the event. And we were supposed to get a special gamer picture that showed us that we were at Zero Hour, and nobody got that.
Well, I think some people did. Just you and I didn't. Like, we went through the process. We went
and Jeff
the...
didn't either.
I didn't try, though. Yeah. I was like, I didn't bother using my gamer tag. I was like, I didn't see the point.
Yeah, you and I went through the line because we wanted the memory unit.
Yeah.
That's how they did it. And we went through the line, went through the computers, and did all that stuff and didn't get it.
Yeah. That sucks.
And to this day, it still shows the first Xbox 360 game I ever played was Quake 4.
Well, I know the first one I ever got Achievement Hunter was Perfect Dark Zero, and I got a headshot one, like 10 headshots.
Oh, that's right. You do have that achievement. Did you get it at 0 Hour? Is that what
I got
it
at 0 Hour.
I always wondered when it was you sat down and played that.
And I remember that thing blipped up on the screen, and I said, "The hell is that?" that's not going anywhere.
That's annoying.
I didn't get a single achievement the whole time we were there.
Really?
Yeah, I think I played that and Dead or Alive 2 or 3 or
Dead or Alive 4.
4.
Yeah.
I don't even remember what I played at that event.
Yeah, we played Quake 4. We played
Madden.
I don't think we ever played any Madden.
I played Madden, I think.
Yeah. All I remember is that the entire... It was in a Air Force base, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it was in a big... It was definitely in a big airplane hangar. And they had filled this thing with green lights. And so the whole... Everything in there was a shade of green. And it was weird at first... But it was much weirder for the several hours after we left that event when we couldn't see other colors on the spectrum. I mean, really, all you saw were shades of black and green. I was literally afraid that it had ruined my vision.
Yeah,
that did fuck with us. You know the thing I remember about that is that we stayed at the hotel in town. It was the last time in my life I think I've been in a town that was so small it only had one hotel.
Yep.
Or a motel, even.
Yep. And it looked like some other
horror movie. How many people went to that event?
Four of us. It was me.
No. I mean, like, total.
Oh, a couple thousand. Probably.
No, just four.
Just four.
It's kind of small.
Us and Kathleen.
Yeah.
It was contest winners and things like that. And I remember, it's hardware launch, so the hardware is very hard to get hold of. Part of the event was Best Buy had an entire line of cash registers where everyone at the event could then buy their 360.
No, it wasn't even
everyone
at the event.
You had to have pre-ordered it.
You had to have pre-ordered. That was the big controversy. Everyone thought they'd be able to buy it there, but then they couldn't.
Oh, really?
That's horrible when that situation unfolds right there, where it's like, here, look, see,
have it. There was also that weird thing at the event where people started stealing beanbags, thinking that they were free.
Oh, yeah.
They had all these white beanbags everywhere, yeah. And people assumed they were free.
Yeah. It was a big thing about that.
They ended up giving them away. I think they ended up letting people take them.
Yeah, that was a fun event, and I still have my 360 launch hoodie. I have that, and I have my Halo 3 launch party t-shirt. And I have an extra one in medium. I should probably give that away on the site.
Yeah, you should. Do a little contest. Do a podcast contest.
I still have that memory card we got when they transferred our Xbox Live accounts from
original
Xbox to 360.
The memory card. I just...
You're just making me mad again that I don't have that gamer pack. I don't know why. I don't know why I care about that. But yeah, my 0 hour attendance. I've never seen those online. Have you ever seen anyone?
No.
Frankie.
Well, it was such a small group of people.
Frankie has one. And I, yeah, but even when I look on like leaderboards and stuff like that. I would expect to see that 0 hour thing showing up more places.
Yeah, I don't know.
And it does go to show that initially they were going to start doing more stuff like they're doing now with Avatar Awards. They did have those plans early on that you could get special gamer picks that other people couldn't get.
Speaking of Avatar Awards, I feel like they finally have hit. You know, I don't know if you've noticed it, but I've been getting them pretty regularly now.
Yeah,
I got a bunch in Left 4 Dead.
Talking about Avatar Awards reminded me, I read this article on Statesman yesterday, and I meant to talk to you all about it. Statesman's the local newspaper. I guess someone at UT is doing a study on video games and video game avatars, and they took people in and then, had them play games and then assigned them avatars randomly. They were either given, avatars wearing all black clothing or all white clothing, and then they were given other avatars that were in costumes, like a generic costume with no meaning attached to it, or they would dress them as KKK members. And they said that every time someone was wearing either black or the KKK outfit, that they were always assholes. That their avatar choice clearly influenced how they behaved in online games.
They
were given the avatar.
Interesting.
And that the people who were given all black clothing or, a charged outfit, like a KKK outfit, they went out and were instigators of trouble.
Immediately became racist.
Interesting.
That is interesting. Hey, before we go, I'd like to ask the three of you, and then also anybody that's listening, a question. I've been playing Fable 2 regularly with my wife, and we're getting pretty close to wrapping it up. We basically just have to do See the Future, and then it's done. And I want to play something with her next that has multiplayer that's similar to Fable 2. Do you have any recommendations?
Armia 2?
No, it's got to be fantasy, I think. It's got to be, have some sort of... Because she likes WoW, she likes Fable 2. I was thinking, I've never played Kingdom of Keflings, but I hear that that's might be fun.
Is that a strategy game or is that an adventure game?
It's like an adventure game.
Is it like, does it have to be, you know, 360 based?
Yeah, it has to be 360.
Why don't you guys play Cameo together since we're talking about launch titles?
Yeah, yeah, we could try that. She might like Cameo.
Let's get co-op. And
I don't like Cameo, but she might like it.
Cameo's a good game.
Is it? Maybe I didn't give it enough of a chance.
I recently read something where they named the top 10 games by platform. Top 10 games on the PS3, top 10 games on the Xbox 360. They put Cameo in the top 10. I wouldn't do that, but it's a good game.
Yeah, it was all right. I remember enjoying it at launch.
You guys have already played Viva and Piñata together, right?
Yeah, and I was thinking she would like Fallout because the story is so good, and I think she would appreciate that because that's like her speed for combat. But there's no multiplayer.
Oh, I know what to do. Borderlands.
Yeah, we're kind of playing Borderlands. We played it for about an hour. Maybe we'll give that
another
run. Oh, it's
not really fantasy, right?
No, it kind of...
It's not like
it's
D&D.
Like sci-fi. She likes sci-fi. Yeah.
The way Fallout is.
Yeah.
Same kind of thing.
But there really isn't like another Fable 2-style action RPG, like a fantasy-style game.
You could play Saints Row together.
Yeah.
I think that
you have two Xboxes in your house.
It's true.
You get all your co-op stuff together too.
It's true.
I think the Borderlands and like Left 4 Dead, where you have like four people co-oping, I think that needs to be incorporated in like every game.
You know, she might like Left 4 Dead. She enjoyed playing it. Maybe she would.
You know
like
what?
Left 4 Dead.
Though not every game has the popularity to support four player co-op, and I think a lot of games are falling into that trap.
Yeah.
I mean, you just start off talking about Left 4 Dead 2, which is a very popular title. It's a very new title, and you're having trouble getting together people to play it.
Yeah.
I mean, even if people are playing it, we've learned recently from the records that have been broken at online people, everyone's on at the same time.
Right. Well, here's the other thing, is just going into like a quick match, that's fine. I'm fine with that.
Yeah, same here.
Okay.
There's two people on my list that I always see playing that I can jump in with, but normally if they're not on, I just go into a quick match.
Who are those two people?
I don't want to give their gamer tags.
Okay.
But big news I forgot to mention earlier in the podcast. World of Warcraft turned 5 this week.
Yeah, it did.
So, Xbox 360 is 4. Big deal. So what?
Five years. Also, I didn't realize this, but the Warcraft series turned 15 years old.
I asked the same question. Joel just asked a question. That's the same question I asked when I read that headline. What was your question, Joel?
World of Warcraft is older than the 360?
Yep, by a year.
That's not what I asked. I can't believe that World of Warcraft is only 5 years old. That seems to me like a 7-year-old, 8-year-old game to me at this point.
When did you start playing? Wow.
It launched, you know, in November of 2004. I started playing January 2005.
Okay, so pretty soon.
How much has it changed since the first?
Oh, Jesus.
Tons, right?
Man.
Yeah, it's not, it's unrecognizable.
You know, I have unintentionally built up a weird kind of collection of video game memorabilia without really trying to do it. I'm not a big collector. I don't like collecting. I think it's one of the lamest hobbies you could possibly have, but I've got that World of Warcraft launch collector's edition that's signed by the entire original development team.
Weird. I didn't know you had gotten that back.
Oh, you mean for my brother?
Yeah.
Yeah, I told him he was going to try to sell it for money, and I said, don't do that. Just give it back to me, and I'll figure out something for it.
That's cool.
So,
what are you going to do with it?
I don't have it back yet, so we'll see. I don't know. I mean, it just seems like it was also the very first item ever auctioned at a Child's Play dinner.
That's pretty cool.
Because it was one of those things where it was the first year of Child's Play. They just started the auction, and I remember the reason I bid on it is because it was this lull kind of... Mm-hmm. Like, everyone's kind of sitting waiting for everyone else to bid, so I just started bidding on it just to kind of get the ball rolling.
Sure.
Maybe you should give it back to Child's Play so they can auction it again and use the money to benefit your brother.
Yeah, maybe so. But the, I wonder if there would be value in giving it back to them and seeing maybe they could re-auction. Do you think anyone's interested in a launch edition of World of Warcraft?
I think there might be a few people interested in that.
I think I know somebody in this room.
What I'm saying is, do you think video game memorabilia is big? I mean, you're a huge WoW player. What would you pay for that?
For that? Here. I mean, I wouldn't, but I could see people paying, you know, it's signed by the launch development team. I could see that going for $4,000 or $5,000.
And does it have a vanity pet?
Yeah. And it has a vanity pet. You can't get anymore.
And here's the thing, you know, I mean, that thing, how can it not be worth a lot more money down the line from here?
I don't think video games hold up the way you think.
Not yet.
We had this conversation a while back, Bernie and I did, and I think we both came to the conclusion that there's no...
Right
There's no
now,
staying power in that.
Right now.
No, I even then, like, there was a time back when PlayStation came out, okay, to give you an example, when to get a copy of Chrono Trigger, you would have to pay $80 or $90. And then they just re-release it on the PlayStation, and then you could get them for, like, $20.
I'm talking about unique items.
Right here, look at this.
Signed.
This is World of Warcraft Collector's Edition Factory Sealed Box. Not even signed. It's got five bids on eBay. It's already $1,025 with 9.5 hours to go.
Well, the one that I bought at Child's Play had a 3-year subscription, which my brother used, and he also used the pet.
Oh,
so,
he used the pet?
Of course he did. You know, I gave it to him as a gift. So I got the thing for $300 at the time. The actual subscription card that came in it, which was good for 3 years, was less or was worth more than the value than what I paid for it at the time.
Yeah,
so.
You get the deal of the century.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool.
It was just weird because nobody was just, you know, nobody was bidding. And then later in the evening, somebody bid $40,000 on nothing. Remember that?
I do.
That kind of got crazy at the Child's Play auction.
Yeah.
$40,000.
Well, wow. Joel, let me give you an example of what you're saying. You're saying that you can't believe stuff isn't worth more.
I'm just saying, that's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, I think given some time, given some more years, I think stuff like this is going to definitely escalate in price.
Stop looking at my screen. Here's an Atari 2600. That's obviously a touchstone for older people, older gamers who have money and could afford to say, oh, I want to play all the old Atari 2600 games I played as a kid.
Yeah.
Here's a working Atari 2600 system with 42 games and all original accessories.
But is it signed by anyone?
No, it's not signed by anybody.
Okay,
how much would you pay for that?
Well,
just guess.
The
system and 42 games.
The system and the way you're painting it right now makes me want to lowball it.
Yeah, it's a good idea. You should.
$100.
$70. So even your lowball, it's like
here's why I don't think it'll have a long-lasting collectability. Okay. The thing that like you wanted to go buy like say you're into like guitars and you go buy an autographed Chuck Berry guitar. All right, and you'll pay $5,000 or $10,000 for that, right? For two reasons: one, everybody knows who Chuck Berry is because he was famous, and two, you could still physically play the guitar. 20 years from now, you're not going to be able to play that copy of World of Warcraft, no matter how collectible it is, because the technology will have so far surpassed it that there's no way to access the entertainment within there, even if WoW still exists. And then two, nobody in the world is going to give a shit who the developers of WoW were in 10 years.
It's a sad fact, but
I mean, I bet nobody in this room can name one of those developers right now. And I don't think that's fair, but that's just the way it is. There's no star power there. Gus might be able to name one or two.
You probably are probably
so
right. What if he had one of the original Macs signed by Steve Jobs?
That's different because you know who Steve Jobs is.
Yes, it's
back in the day, did anyone know who Steve Jobs was? Like, let's say before Steve Jobs.
Yeah, well, that's possible if that like some developer on WoW becomes a billionaire and, you know, develops some huge product line, maybe.
Starts leading Blizzard and makes them, you know, turns them from losing money to making
money. I hear what you're saying.
I don't think there's a long-term inherent collectability in software.
Who do you think is the most famous person in all of video game development?
Richard Garriott.
I'm thinking more like Cliffy B, maybe.
Let's take out the Japanese guys. Because that's a different category, Miyamoto and those guys. So just American video game developers.
Most famous or most known name? Probably today, Cliffy B, I would think.
Because this is weird, too. I have stuff signed by Richard Garriott. I have, like, the Ultima 4, the fourth one off the production line signed by Richard Garriott that I got at another auction. Unintentionally, I got that. I have a floppy disk copy of Alcabeth, which is, I think, one of only 7 in the world.
Yeah. And I think that's very collectible now. I don't know that in 10 years it will be.
I wonder if you said Richard Garriott because you know because you were at that event with him.
Well, I just know he's a recognizable name. I probably could have said American McGee there's a bunch of people out there.
I wouldn't put him up there. I'd put like Cliffy B and maybe like
John Carmack.
You could put up there. But the thing is, like, Richard Garriott is a guy who was very influential to gaming. I mean, you spent your entire childhood playing his games, right?
Yep.
And he was a big deal, and he's a really big deal to you. But I would wage that because he doesn't make relevant games anymore and his last game was kind of a failure, that there are, like, I don't know, if you pulled 50% of the Xbox 360 users, they would have no idea who he was.
I bet most of the people who, when you said his name here, most people would have to look him up.
Yeah. And, like, his fame isn't going to exist, you know, because games come out so quickly and the technology changes so much that I don't think that a lot of those people have any kind of staying power. And maybe Richard Garriott's collectibles are worth $4,000 or $5,000 right now, but I think those will actually deteriorate in time.
It's so funny, you know, because it's like you think about professional sports or other things where you have stars and this, that, and the other thing. Man, video games is the one medium where it is just about the game.
It is. It's just the
product itself.
Temporary, like, you can, for the next 50 years, you'll be able to go back and watch Michael Jordan clips and go, those are amazing, right?
Right, there's
but
no, right.
You can't go back. Nobody really wants to go back and play those old games. Or, like, I'm not going to go
back.
No one
holds
and,
up. Yeah, like,
yeah, they don't
was,
hold
what
up.
What was the guy that was on 60 Minutes? Fatality?
Oh, yeah.
Like, that guy, he's supposed to be a big star, wins lots of events, you know, does all the stuff, you know.
And Also, it's a medium where every 3 years you replace whatever it is with a new version of it, and then the old one becomes antiquated.
What's your point on Fatality? I want to hear you finish that thought.
He's not that important.
No.
He's just not that important. But that's the other thing. Like, the way technology is right now and the way it's evolving so quickly, are we going to get to a point where it sort of plateaus enough where it's like we have enough processing power or whatever where we'll just stop evolving? So we'll hit a point where it's almost enough. Is that
you mean like film? Saying?
Like a microwave almost. Like it's like we get to like film, anything, you know, where it's like, okay, here we are. This is going to kind of be it for the next. I don't know. Maybe not.
Yeah, I mean, we really don't know the early film guys. Nobody talks about them. I mean, when you think about the earliest person you know who worked in film, you get down to like Charlie Chaplin,
like Valentino, those kind
of
guys.
I mean, there was a lot of people before that were working in the early days. That when you see it, you hear the same thing you hear about old games now. You look at it, and somebody tells you how important this thing was, and you're like, yeah, okay, it's a. You know,
yeah, it's a guy running.
Yeah, it's a guy running. Or yeah, they shot a cannon at the moon. Okay, it looks pretty good. Yeah, like, but at the time, this was crazy. You know,
you don't even have to go that far back. You could go back to Hitchcock and like go back and watch Psycho. It's not that great of a
Citizen movie. Kane. It's a good
Citizen
example.
Kane, well, I think Citizen Kane holds up pretty well, but like Psycho was so terrifying. I watched this documentary on Hitchcock
that
women were fleeing the theater 45 minutes in crying because they couldn't stand what they were seeing on screen.
Right.
And it's so like vanilla now to watch it. And it's actually kind of there's not a scary moment in Psycho.
Right. Sure.
There's not a suspenseful moment. But at the time when it hit, it was terrifying. And but yet, they killed What's-Her-Face.
A Hitchcock signed poster of Psycho would sell extremely well.
Probably.
It would definitely be worth more than the poster was when it originally sold. Yeah. This Atari 2600, that's probably $1,500 worth of equipment bought in 1978 or whatever, you know, 1982. Now it's worth $70.
Yeah. I guess the thing that I'm thinking is that if it doesn't stop, if technology just keeps rapidly evolving like this, it seems like there's no time for to get a hook, you know, where I don't know, people understand. You know, I don't know. Which thereby puts value on things.
Sure. But if you're in Japan and you had a Miyamoto signed copy of, you know, the original Mario Brothers, what would that be worth? Probably a lot of money.
Probably.
Or who's the dude who makes Metal Gear that everybody loves so much?
Well, here's another thing. Like, the Mario thing has been a franchise forever. You know, you understand Mario back then, understand
that is associated with one person, even though clearly that guy's not making all the games.
It's like a lot of things have got to happen. A lot of stars have got to line up.
Yeah. Yeah.
A lot of stars have got to line up.
Well, Joel, you don't follow this stuff quite as closely as we do. Who is the most famous person you can name from video game development?
That's the thing. I couldn't. I would have to. All of the people you mentioned, I don't know. Garriott, I know, but I probably knew just because of conversations around here.
Yeah.
Like, I would want to say the two guys that make the two guys that started Grand Theft Auto. But I don't even know their names. You know, the guys that just left.
No, I don't know.
Start their own company.
To answer your question, a year and a half ago, a Miyamoto signed Super Famicom went on eBay for about $1,500.
The Super Famicom is the predecessor to the NES.
Well, the Super Famicom is the Japanese equivalent of the Super NES.
Yeah.
Okay. I still think what I said was correct. I think their Super Nintendo preceded our regular Nintendo.
Do you think that... do you think... What has more? People who follow the NFL, fans of the NFL, or people who play video games? All video games.
Video games.
Well, how many copies of Madden sold?
I don't think that's an accurate way to look at that, but... It's got to be NFL because NFL's on TV and it plays every week.
But
it's
let's talk about worldwide, right? Gaming is worldwide.
Oh.
Yeah, hands down gaming.
Well, I'm going to say I'm going to say gaming probably.
Probably more soccer fans than gaming fans though.
And what's worldwide. Your point here?
Well, it's funny because video gaming makes more money probably than a medium like the NFL. It has more fans, if you want to call it that, more people that actively engage in it. I think.
Right.
I don't know. I think. Video games mean more to me than what the NFL does. I put more money into video games, but it's still there's still no value there. I'd rather have a signed helmet by, you know.
Video games are more of a product. Like Coca-Cola's makes more money than say indoor soccer. But there's a lot of people who'd be much more interested in meeting a guy on the indoor soccer team than the CEO of Coca-Cola.
I guess that's what it is because it's like there's that exclusivity. Where it's like if you're watching somebody in the NFL, it's like, wow, that's a rare thing.
The product is not the person, right? That's the thing, is that in all these other things, the product is the people.
Yeah.
You know? NFL, the team is a bunch of people. So you can meet those people.
But they're playing a game.
You know, if we get to the point where you can actually meet a character in a game, that might be an interesting thing.
Well, you can meet how. You can meet the developers. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, that's not the same thing.
It's like meeting Jerry Jones or something.
Yeah, it's not the same thing. I mean, there's a reason why people would probably want to meet Daniel Radcliffe more than J.K. Rowling.
That's a great example. Yeah.
You know, is she wrote the book? She wrote Harry Potter. He is Harry Potter. It's a different thing entirely. I mean, how many of these girls do you think would scream at the top of their lungs when the Twilight author walks through the room?
Right.
They're not going to do it. You know what I mean? By the way, I love that. Can I tell you how much I love the Twilight thing? Everyone makes fun of it. I don't know, you know, people who are in that geek or nerd culture or whatever, they tend to make fun of other stuff that other people like that they don't like, which is so stupid.
Yeah.
I think it's all connected. You know, you talk about the NFL. I love that sports guys will make fun of, say, like cosplayers, and yet they'll go to the football game in a jersey, you know?
That's true.
You know, they dress up like the players on the field and they go to a football game, but they don't see the correlation.
Look at some of those Raider fans.
Wear a big wedge of cheese on their head.
Yeah, they dress up with, like ladies with pig noses for the Redskins. Sorry, Joel. I know you're Redskins.
Hey. And a fan of pigs.
By the way, we should talk about the Silver Dome in just 1 second.
Yeah.
But I love Twilight. I love that in 2009 that there is still something in the world that makes teenage girls scream at the top of their lungs.
Well, there always will be, right?
I hope so. I hope we don't get to the point where everyone is so jaded. You know,
there always will be.
I'm glad. I'm glad that it still exists because I would not have been able to think of what that would be that would make girls scream uncontrollably at the top of their lungs.
Have you seen any of the movies?
What's that?
I saw Twilight, the first movie. I saw it on a plane.
What'd you think? I mean,
was almost unwatchably bad. It was atrocious.
Here's the funny thing.
There was no plot introduced into that film until an hour and 30 minutes in.
Really?
It was bizarre.
Because to me, it seems like to reach that sort of audience, to make that sort of money, it has to be very formulaic. That's the only way you sort of reach that.
Oh, yeah. It's just about teen angst. I mean, but I can see why it appeals. And I'm sure the books... I would never compare a book to a movie from a quality standpoint. I'm sure the book is a lot better.
Here's a weird thing, though. Like, if you watch a movie like Twilight and you don't like it, you know, you have some years on you, obviously, and it's like, I've seen the story before. Whatever. You just don't like it. You know, you've been introduced to that formula enough times. But yet, if you're a filmmaker, it's like, well, I know all the elements are involved in this. You know, hire a good-looking guy, whatever. Put all the variables together. I could write this and produce this, but at the same time, you'd have no respect for your own work. Could you do it?
Yes. Could I do it?
We were talking about that on a corporate level just a little while ago. We were talking about could you build a company?
It becomes a product.
Yeah. You don't care if this thing actually makes money just so you can sell it to somebody else, you know. You don't care if this thing has value. You just care that you can sell it to somebody.
Other people will find it.
But it does have value.
I don't know. You know.
It has $140 million worth of value.
There you go. Well, yeah. You
know? That's a lot of millions.
That's its money. That's what it makes. When you talk about value means something entirely different to me. I mean, that's monetary.
But in entertainment, it's totally different, I think.
But here's the other thing. There is value in Twilight. I'm sorry, say that?
I said there is value in Twilight, obviously, to millions of fans who read the books.
Right.
Some of our wives are into Twilight.
Sure.
I mean, you know.
I was like, get on that road. It's weird and creepy, you know.
But I don't know.
What's your point? What are you trying to say?
I don't know. If you're a filmmaker, it's like most of the things, especially young filmmakers, it's like, I want to become a filmmaker because I want to say what I want to say, or I want to tell the story that I want to tell.
And
then other part of it is like, also, I'll make lots of money.
I would so disagree with what you're saying.
Oh, yeah?
I don't think that's the path for most people anymore. I don't think people have something they want to say. I think you can very clearly people that have something they want to say because their first thing is very good.
Yeah.
I mean, most of the time, what you're talking about, those artists, you see something comes out, it's like, wow, this first thing they put out is tremendous, and there's a steady decline because they have less and less things to say. I think now people who go through all the effort of making productions, and they don't have anything to say.
No, but what I'm saying is, what is the main motivation for people who want to be filmmakers?
I think people want to be famous. Hmm. I think that's the thing now, is that everybody just wants to be famous, right?
I don't know who directed Twilight, but I wouldn't say that the guy set out to make a bad movie either, though.
Catherine Hardwicke. I just looked it up.
I'm sure she put a lot of work and effort into it, and I'm sure she made what she thinks is a really good movie.
I feel like when I was in Hollywood, there was a lot of, like, basically, like, you had people working on projects, movies, TV shows, and it was just, like, very workmanlike. Where you think it's a position of art and there's no art, where it's just like, I will take this variable, I will put this variable into the formula, I will take this variable, I'll put this variable in the formula.
Let me ask you this, because you worked on Angel for a very long time, for like 5 or 6 years, however long Angel was on the air for. at some point, at some level, I'm assuming it's at Josh Whedon, there is somebody that cares and is trying to make the best possible story.
Absolutely true. Like, Joss Whedon, he, I think, cared, and it's like he wrote something that he loved.
Yeah.
Same with Firefly.
Sure.
But he was, you know, that's the great thing right there, is if you can operate on two levels, where you can both satisfy your own creative itch, and it also appeals to people.
Yeah.
But it didn't appeal to people enough, because...
Well, and it's still lasted for a long time. I mean, at the height of its popularity, that show was at more popular than Buffy. I don't know if you know that.
Well, I guess I always go to, like, Firefly, you know, because it always seemed like to me that was the project that he liked the most, I imagined. And
that had the least success.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Did you ever see Lords of Dogtown, Jeff?
The documentary or the movie?
The movie.
No. Okay. I saw the documentary.
This the same woman who Dogtown directed Twilight directed Lords of Dogtown.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. I don't know if that was any good or not. I wanted to see it.
I didn't know who wrote Twilight.
She was also a production designer on Car 54, Where Are You, the movie, and Tank Girl.
Car 54, Where Are You? You know, I credit Tank Girl as being one of the first comic book movies in the current generation of comic book movies.
Sure. There's a lot of people that like that movie. I thought that movie was horrible.
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Yeah.
I saw it in Germany at a movie theater that served beer. It was the most novel thing in the world to me, and now I do it every week.
Now you take it for granted.
Yeah.
God, I haven't seen her in a long time either. Lori Petty, right? Yeah.
I just saw her in Point Break the other day.
Nice.
Oh, and in Free Willy, because Millie was on a Free Willy kick for a while.
Were you going to say something about the Silver Dome? Did I hear that?
Oh. Yeah, we found this out. The Pontiac Silver Dome, which was the former home of the Detroit Lions, recently sold in Detroit.
I didn't even realize they had moved to a new stadium.
Correct?
Yes.
And it was sitting vacant, and they sold the property.
When did they move from...
I didn't even know.
No, but do we know?
No. I'll check my Detroit Lions newsletter. but they sold the Pontiac Silver Dome for $580,000?
I think you're correct.
Somewhere in that neighborhood?
That seems like a steal.
Do we know who bought it?
Quite literally a steal, because 40 years ago, apparently it was a bond... Taxpayers paid $54 million to build that stadium.
Wow.
And it sold for $580,000.
That's some serious depreciation.
It was some, like, Canadian dude or something, right, that bought it?
God.
I think. I could be wrong about that.
Who knows?
But just some dude. What do you do with
wonder,
the Silver Dome?
Yeah, exactly. Like, what's going to happen?
You had the most badass house ever.
I had heard that the plan for it was to make it an indoor soccer stadium. But still, $580,000.
Hopefully the losingest soccer team ever will play there.
That scares the hell out of me. I don't know why. It's like Detroit is becoming this vortex.
Yeah.
It's really, really scary.
Well, dude,
that's a stadium, dude. That's a stadium. A dome stadium. $580,000.
When the recession first was at its peak, and there were all the stories about Detroit, Gus and I went and did home searches in Detroit. And you could buy like 3,000 square foot, like 100-year-old manor-style homes that in Austin would be like $1.2 million, you could buy them for like $6,000 and $7,000. It
Yikes.
Was crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, it's Yikes. Amazing.
You could buy a neighborhood and make it a good neighborhood.
You could. You could buy a neighborhood and make the neighborhood good, right? Just put a gate up.
Wow. Put a wall.
Yeah.
You know, with
that's the thing. It gets to a point where it just gets to be crazy, crazy value, and then that's when it will turn. And hopefully that's the turning point for them.
To answer your earlier question, Joel, the Lions played their first game at Ford Field on September 22nd, 2002.
Yeah.
Wow.
They've been out of the Silverdome for a while.
Yeah. And luckily they got in there and had their big 0-18 season. Good for them.
Well, I guess that's part of how you get to that price, right? Is it probably been sitting there for a long time.
Yeah. Wikipedia defines that season as the historic 2008 season.
Nice. Toronto developer Andreas Apostolopoulos. That's his name. Read that. How do you read that, Joel? What is that name? Apostolopoulos.
That is the greatest name I've ever seen in my life.
Is that Greek?
And very Canadian, clearly, Canadian name. Thought the same thing, took his money to the third world city of Detroit and bought the freaking Silver Dome for $583.
Third world city of Detroit.
$80,000.
Whatever. I mean, it's close enough.
Yeah.
The difference between $583, $583,000 when you start at an asking price of $55 million, it's insignificant. To build, it cost $55 million to build.
So Wow. We could have bought it for Rooster Teeth World Headquarters.
It seats 80,000 people.
Should have.
Could have had a good studio there.
We'd have to hire a lot of people to fill that seat. Those seats.
It's got 80,000 seats. Okay.
Okay.
So think about that. At $10 a seat, it should have sold for $800,000. They made less selling it than they did filling it in one day.
You're absolutely correct. One football game would have quadrupled the sales of that place.
I mean, literally, you could all pool your money together buying tickets and say, let's just buy this place. It's like being in a bar and like, hey, we should buy our own bar.
That's the thing. It's got to be a situation where you can go on eBay right now. You can like look for the Magnum PI Ferrari, and you can buy that for $25,000. The problem is that the second engine service for that car is $10,000. So sunken costs that are...
So you're saying that the upkeep...
What's a second engine?
The second engine service.
What's a second engine?
No, the second time you get the engine service.
Oh, it's $10,000.
Yeah.
Well,
so
I mean...
So you're saying the upkeep makes it not worth
it? There's got to be, right?
Would you really...
I mean, what's the electricity bill for one day?
Would you make that your daily driver? I mean, really? Would you? Like, and you're not buying the Magnum PI Hawaiian shirt to wear it around town, you know?
I would buy Higgins, though.
What's Higgins?
Higgins is Butler. Butler.
I never watched Magnum PI. I don't know anything about it. It's before my time.
We should probably start wrapping this up. We're going real long today.
How long do we go?
Pretty long.
It's going to crash.
Yeah. Is there lots of stuff to cut?
I don't know. We'll find out. How about we end the podcast first?
All right, let's go get some lunch and mull it over.
Yeah, let's GPS our lunch.
Yeah, right. I hope there's not a lot to cut. Guests might want a personal day after.
All right, thanks for listening, everyone.
Ta-ta.
Hop on the old drunk tank. Hop on the old drunk tank. It's where all the gamers come rave and rant. So hop on the old drunk tank. Woo-hoo. Sit back, relax, because it's time for the drunk tank.
I feel like I'm back in Alabama.